John Daly speaking from a hidden cleft of rocks just below the famous dueling grounds on the heights of Weehawken, New Jersey, directly across the Hudson River from New York City. On this morning of July 11, 1804, a small boat is making its way from the New York side of the river towards this point. The boat is about 200 yards away and five men are aboard. It's a very clear, sunny morning. Visibility is excellent, and I can say without doubt that one of the men in that boat is the Vice President of the United States, Mr. Aaron Burr. Although in itself there is nothing extraordinary in the fact that Mr. Burr is on a boat crossing the Hudson River this morning, yet the event...
July 11, 1804, Weehawken, New Jersey. You are there.
Aaron Burr on his way to the dueling grounds at Weehawken, New Jersey. CBS takes you back 144 years to the climactic moment in the lifetime conflict between two of the most famous men in American history. All things are as they were then, except for one thing. When CBS is there...
You are there.
You Are There, produced and directed by Robert Louis Cheyenne, is based on authentic historical fact and quotation. And now...
July 11, 1804. The dueling grounds at Weehawken, New Jersey, and John Daly.
This shore on this morning of July 11, 1804... means, we believe, that Mr. Burr is coming to this famous dueling ground to fight the leader of the Federalist Party and this nation's first Secretary of the Treasury, Mr. Alexander Hamilton. You will naturally ask how CBS comes by this intelligence, since there has been absolutely no indication that a duel between Colonel Burr and General Hamilton was in the offing. CBS heard a rumor that the duel would take place here this morning, and here is Ned Kelmer to tell you about that rumor.
This duel is supposed to be a secret, but we have it on good authority that at least seven prominent persons know about it, and perhaps as many as ten. When CBS heard the rumor, and naturally we're not at liberty to disclose its source, we immediately tried to check it, but could find no corroboration. However, as John Daly has just told you, Colonel Burr and General Hamilton are old political enemies. John and I have been hidden here in the rocks below the dueling ground since dawn. The shore directly across from us is black with forest, or in some places, bright with sloping lawn. Farther downstream is New York City proper, a teeming metropolis of some 30,000 people. There was always the possibility, of course, that the rumor of the duel would prove false, but as soon as we recognized Colonel Burr on that boat, we knew that the rumor was true, and we went on the air to bring you an eyewitness account of this affair. John, you've been studying the boat while I've been talking. Do you recognize any of the men with Colonel Burr?
Well, I've recognized two of them. One is Mr. Matthew Davis, a New York politician. The other is Mr. William Van Ness, a well-known New York lawyer. Both Mr. Davis and Mr. Van Ness are old friends of Colonel Burr's. The man at the oars, I suppose, is the professional bargeman hired to row the party across. And the last man I can't recognize. Perhaps he's a doctor or another friend of Aaron Burr's. Colonel Burr is seated in the stern of the boat next to Mr. Van Ness. Both men are facing this way, but they can't see us because these rocks in which we are hiding are screened from the river by foliage and bushes. Our vantage point is also hidden from the dueling ground directly above us, although we can observe it through a crevice in the rocks. Of course, our own boat by which we crossed the river is hidden upstream.
Just a second. Another boat is coming this way now from the New York side, John. It's also coming upstream from the direction of the village of Greenwich. It looks as though there are four men aboard. I can't tell yet whether it's General Hamilton's party. It could be just a group getting an early start for a picnic up the river. And yet the chances are very good that it is Hamilton. Our tip about the duel came from a very reliable source. Though dueling to settle questions of honor is a common practice these days, as you know, it's forbidden by law both in New York and New Jersey, and any participants or witnesses are technically liable to fines and even jail. So dueling parties have to be careful and cautious. CBS is well aware that by broadcasting this duel, we might be accused of technical violation of the law. However, this is no ordinary duel, and CBS considers itself reluctantly obliged to report this event.
For the moment, Ned, let's turn our attention to Colonel Burr's party, which has just landed. Their boat has been made fast to a large boulder about 20 feet below and downstream. All five men are hurrying up the rocks now to our right, and from now on, Ned Kelmer and I will lower our voices lest we be overheard. Van Ness is in the lead, Aaron Burr directly behind, the other three following. They've passed out of sight for the moment, hidden by the rocks directly to our right, but should appear, reappear on the dueling ground behind us. The shelf, the actual dueling ground, is a level clearing about 15 paces long, no more than 6 feet wide. Behind it rises the sheer rock wall of the heights. There is nothing but rock to the left and the right of it. If you can imagine a gigantic bird's nest hollowed in a cliff, rock on three sides and bushes on the other, well, then you have a picture of it. Incidentally, this dueling ground is the exact place where General Hamilton's eldest son, Philip, was killed in a duel 3 years ago, almost to the day. No one has appeared yet up on... Oh, I beg your pardon. Mr. Van Ness has appeared. He's climbing up on the grassy shelf. He carries a small pistol case under one arm and an umbrella. Just why the umbrella is a mystery, for it certainly doesn't look like rain today. He's up on the level ground now. He's turned to help Colonel Burr, but the latter ignores his hand, steps up upon the ledge himself. Both men have paused. They're looking the ground over, moving toward the center of the shelf. I don't know where the other three men are, but very probably they're hiding on the other side of the ledge. Colonel Burr and Mr. Van Ness are standing directly in the center of the ledge now. We're slightly underneath it, looking up at it, and a few yards upstream from it. That's as close as we dare get. To get closer is to risk discovery and revealing to the duelists that we are here. So it's as if we were seated in the orchestra of a theater, a little to the right and looking up at the stage.
Just a minute, John. That boat out there is no picnic party. It's turning into this shore. The boat is still too far away for me. No, I can see. There are four men aboard. And yes, it is General Hamilton and his party. The rumor was true. There is to be an appointment of honor between Aaron Burr and General Hamilton. The Hamilton boat is going to land a trifle upstream from where we are now. So let's turn our attention back to the dueling ground.
Colonel Burr and Mr. Van Ness are looking the ledge over, talking quietly. We can't hear what they're saying, but we have planted a microphone in the rocks surrounding the ledge. The men aren't standing very close to it, but maybe, just maybe, we can pick up some of that conversation. So let's open the hidden microphone and listen.
Yes, it's nice to have them taking off. Now, suppose you take that side and drive it on here. Very well. We can lay our toast on this log. Be careful of the crystal gate. Yes, I'll put it down here.
As we feared, the men are too far away, so we might just as well shut that hidden microphone off. Both Burr and Mr. Van Ness have taken off their coats. They've laid them on a log, along with a pistol case and that umbrella. If our vice president is nervous, he certainly shows no sign of it. As a matter of fact, you might think that once the ledge is cleared to his satisfaction, he'll spread a lunch out upon the grass and then sit down and enjoy it. They've paused now. They're looking over the ground that they've cleared of shrubbery and underbrush, talking to each other, seated on a log, waiting patiently. Both of them are very calm.
The Hamilton boat is landing now. As we explained, it's only about 20 feet from here down to the river. But the boat is landing upstream about 30 yards, as I make it, to my left. The sun is shining on the backs of the four men. There's General Hamilton. Yes, I recognize David Hossack, General Hamilton's personal physician, the well-known New York doctor. I don't know who the fourth man... Yes, I do. He's Nathaniel Pendleton, the prominent consular at law. Both of the duelists, please notice, have lawyers as seconds. Van Ness, Burr's man, is a lawyer, and so is Pendleton, acting for General Hamilton.
These names may prove confusing, Ned, so let's get it straight. Pendleton is Hamilton's second, and Van Ness is Burr's.
That's it. And now the boat has touched the bank. The bargeman is jumping ashore, making fast. Mr. Pendleton is on land, followed by General Hamilton. Now Dr. Hossack. Pendleton and the general are now coming up over the rocks to the dueling ground. Dr. Hossack and the bargeman are directly below us. They seem to be headed for the hideout where Colonel Burr's friends are located. Colonel Burr and Mr. Van Ness haven't moved from that log they're sitting on. At this moment, they look like two statues. Mr. Pendleton's head is appearing over the ledge. Now he's on solid ground. General Hamilton quickly following. They're both watching Colonel Burr and Mr. Van Ness. Colonel Burr picks up his black silk coat from a log. He's putting it on, bowing to the new arrivals. And they, in turn, acknowledge the greeting. Now they're all grouped within a few feet of each other, somewhat closer to our hidden microphone. Let's try it again.
No matter. Bring it on with it, by all means. Very well.
That's really unfortunate. I'd give anything to bring you that conversation clearly. But the men keep moving, so we'll close the mic again. Hamilton has said very little so far. Burr has said nothing at all. Neither of the principals has spoken one word to the other. The seconds seem to be doing all the talking. Mr. Pendleton is carrying a pistol case, not unlike Mr. Van Ness's. Undoubtedly, Dr. Hossack is here to attend either man. Everything seems to be quite friendly. But the seconds are opening the pistol cases, drawing forth the weapons. They're really going to fight.
We had hoped that this would not happen, but it is happening now. The seconds are examining the pistols carefully. They both seem to be satisfied, and they've begun to measure off the ground while Burr and Hamilton look on. 7, 8, 9, 10. Exactly 10 paces. They're marking the spots where the contestants will stand and fire. Duelists do not place their backs to each other, then walk the 10 paces, turn and fire, as is done in Europe. Here, in this country, they fire from fixed positions. Colonel Burr and General Hamilton have still not spoken to each other, and if they intend to settle this matter peacefully, they'd better hurry, because the seconds are now loading the pistols. General Hamilton is rather nervous. He seems to be. He shifts his feet about a great deal. The general is 47, a year younger than Burr. Physically, however, the two men are amazingly alike, small and slender. They carry themselves with a military bearing. Their eyes are penetrating, their voices soothing. I've heard them many times at the bar pleading cases against each other. Both are, as they always are, fashionably dressed. The pistols are loaded now, and I suppose that the seconds are going to draw straws to decide which... No, Mr. Pendleton is flipping a coin instead. It strikes the ground, and he smiles. Evidently, he won the choice as to where General Hamilton will stand, and it also means that Pendleton will give the order to fire. The seconds now handing the pistols to the opponents. Burr and Hamilton are walking to their positions. And if Mr. Pendleton won that toss, and I think he did, he's certainly not giving Hamilton, his own man, the advantage. He's chosen the upper end of the ledge for Hamilton, which at this hour isn't the best. Hamilton will have to face the morning sun and the glare of the river. The men are standing on their marks, waiting. Colonel Burr is facing westward toward the heights, his left side and his shoulder drenched in sunlight. Hamilton's back is to the heights. He's gazing over the river toward the city. The cavity of rocks in which he stands is hardly 4 feet wide. Makes a perfect background with himself as target. The seconds have retired out of range. It doesn't look as though anything could stop them now. They've gone so far. Mr. Pendleton is stating the final instructions. He's speaking loudly, so we'll open our hidden microphone.
I'm going to give them loudly once more. Listen carefully as I repeat. I shall loudly and distinctly give the word present. Any time after the word present, you may fire as soon as you please. If one of the parties fires and the other has not fired, the opposite second shall say 1, 2, 3, fire, and he shall then fire or lose his shot. A snap or a flash is a fire. Are the gentlemen ready?
I'm sure you heard him clearly. These rocks give a curious echo effect now. Both men are poised, waiting. When Mr. Pendleton calls present, you'll hear firing. No, General Hamilton has stepped to one side. Perhaps he's decided not to fight. Hamilton is speaking to his second. Now he's leveling his pistol in different directions. Can you figure out what's wrong, Ned?
He may be having trouble with the light, John. Now he's leveling his pistol again. No, he's reaching into his pocket for something. Spectacles.
That's it, spectacles. Hamilton is putting them on, is putting the spectacles on. And again, he says something to Mr. Pendleton and tests the light. Now he's repeating the experiment and still again looking toward the sun, pointing the pistol in various directions. Colonel Burr stands immobile, his face a mask. General Hamilton seems to be... Yes, he is. He's apologizing for delaying the fight. He's in his proper place now. Mr. Pendleton has walked away, has stepped out of range once again. Colonel Burr is towing the ground, which is loose with scattered pebbles. Mr. Pendleton is ready to give the order to fire.
Are you ready?
General Hamilton says he is. Colonel Burr nods yes.
Present!
Both men are lifting their pistols, taking aim. Burr is staggering. He's been hit. No, his foot slid on a stone. A clipped tree branch is dropping beside him where Hamilton's bullet struck, and it's Hamilton who's been hit. He's...